pleased to launch this new suite webinar series. The seminar, as you know, takes place every 2 weeks on Tuesday at 4 p.m. Serge Garcia, who chairs these sessions, will give us details about its organization, which will be the same for all seminars, all the next one. Don't hesitate to contact a member of the organizing committee. They are all on our website. You can suggest improvements about the form of the seminar. Serge, before giving you the floor, I would also like to say that I'm very happy that it is Nicolas Trèche with his very interesting paper. We inaugurate the SWIT seminar. So Serge, you have the floor, and a good seminar for everybody.
Yeah, thank you, Lionel. So some information about the seminar. It is the presentation is 45 minutes itself, and then 15 minutes of question. All microphones are cut closed. It's not for censoring, but to avoid some parasite noise. So you can't ask a question by speaking, but you can write your question. And Lionel and me will select this question to ask to Nicola at the end of his presentation. Except if one question is very important for the following of the presentation of Nicola. So I'm very glad to welcome and to introduce Nicola. Nicola Trèche is a senior researcher at INRAE in the lab TSER, that means Toulouse School of Economics Research. Is one of the few economists working on the economics of animal welfare, and so is going to present us an article entitled "An Economic Model of the Meat Paradox." So, Nicola, it's up to you. Thank you very much.
Okay. Serge, it's okay. You see.
We can't hear you very much. Very well. Yeah, maybe your microphone. There is a problem with your microphone.
Oh, that's. So maybe let me remove my.
And now, is it better?
Yeah, it's better.
Okay, so I'm going. Okay, so thank you very much for the invitation. I'm very honored to start this series, and congratulations for this initiative. It's very nice. And I'm also happy to have the opportunity here to present my paper with Nina and Eve about animal welfare and consumption behavior. So Nina and Eve were PhD students in Toulouse, and now Nina is in St. Andrews and Eve is in Munich. So the topic of this paper is, so we have a model of cognitive dissonance. There is a very long standing literature in psychology about cognitive dissonance. However, in economics, it's really a very small field or very small topic. There are just a few papers. It's an emerging topic. And so the basic idea of cognitive dissonance is that people can choose their beliefs. And so in general, in economics, we don't have that. People don't choose belief. People can update belief. Possibly choose the set of information, but they don't really choose beliefs. So this is in fact, probably the main originality of this topic. People can choose beliefs, and you will see how we do that. We follow the model of, we adapt the model of Ben Abutirol. And the story of his paper, so the application is animal welfare, is very simple to understand. And it's about an externality. So even if you don't really care too much about animal welfare, you can just, when I will talk about animals, you can just replace animals by externality, the environment, others, and the model applies. So it's an application to animal welfare, but the model, I think, is much more general. So the idea is that there is an agent who is making an action. He gets a benefit from this action, but this agent is also generating an externality. And he cares about the externality. So there is a sort of behavioral aspect here. He's altruistic, or he has warm glow, or he feels guilt. And the story is such that this person can change his beliefs about the externality. He can adjust his beliefs. He can typically make up stories, for instance, to downplay the externality, so that he feels better. He reduces the guilt associated with that externality. So, for instance, it's the story of someone who is polluting. He has to take his car every day, and he knows he pollutes. He feels bad about that, and to reduce this feeling, this guilt, he may adjust his beliefs to reduce, for instance, the perceived externality. So that's the general story, and we apply it to animals, to animal welfare, as we will see. Okay, so let me. Okay, so now let me get into the paper. So what's the meat paradox, which is in the title? It's a cognitive dissonance, and it's an hypothesis. The hypothesis is the following. Consistent with cognitive dissonance, there is a tension between two cognitions, or here an action and a belief. So the tension could be as followed. We care about animals. We don't want animals to suffer. We don't want to feel responsible for animal suffering. That's one aspect. And on the other hand, we like to eat animals. We like to eat meat. And so the hypothesis is that this creates cognitive dissonance. We may feel bad about this because there is possibly a tension between one and two. And we can conceive it as a cost. It's a cost of guilt. Psychic cost of guilt, and we may naturally want to reduce it. So in some behavioral economics model with guilt or altruism, a natural way will be to change the action. So we can, for instance, reduce meat consumption. We can become flexitarian or vegetarian or vegan. We can also better select the meat we choose. So that's one direction, we change action. But the other direction, and that's the core really of cognitive dissonance, is that we can engage in self-deception. We can just try to manipulate our beliefs. And we will see how we can model it. And so the idea of the paper is just to develop a model of this meat paradox and examine its economic implication. And so, for instance, in that model, we will explore what happens if the price of externality change, of a consumption good that generate an externality change, or what happens if the feeling of guilt change, or if the information change, and so on. Okay, but that will be the contribution. So let me skip that for the sake of time. So I will spend some time trying to motivate the meat paradox. And then I will go into the model, and the final version of the paper, we just have a model. We don't have the motivation part. We designed a survey that we eventually didn't put in the last version, and I will present that quickly. So what's the meat paradox? So there is a lot about that on the web, this possible ambivalence or schizophrenia by some omnivores. The idea is that we seem to treat differently some animals depending on whether we eat them, for instance. We treat differently pets and farm animals. We also treat differently farm animals and wild animals. You can see the cartoon here on my slide where many people illustrating the fact that many people seem to care about wild animals. They seem to care when they see a lion killed in the savannah by a rich American, and on the other end, they don't seem to care much about the misery of the life of many farm animals. And some people claim that it's a bit inconsistent, and that could be consistent with a meat paradox. We would change our belief about farm animals to reduce the feeling of guilt associated with meat consumption. Let me show you a scientific study about that in psychology. It's a small sample. So here in that sample, they ask students to assess the mind, so cognitive ability essentially of animals, and the edibility of animals, so how much they are fit for consumption. And you can see on the bottom right that those animals who are perceived as not edible and with high mind are typically wild animals and pets. So you have here the lion, the elephant, the monkey, the dog, the cat, the gorilla, and so on. And on the other end, in the middle top, so animals with average mind and high edibility, you have most of a farm animal, like chicken, cow, sheep, goat, and so on. Okay. So one interpretation of this result, which is consistent with the meat paradox, is that we deny the mind of animals when we perceive them as food. And that's consistent with the meat paradox, because essentially, believing that animals have less mind reduce the feeling of guilt associated with consumption. And that could be seen as inconsistent, because there is a lot of evidence that many farm animals are as smart, even more than some pets or some wild animals. To go a little bit further, and I'm going to try to be fast on this, we designed a survey study, and our objective in the survey study was to see whether there is a relationship between the perception of farm animal suffering, quote unquote suffering, and meat consumption. So we have a representative population here, about 3,000 people. And we ask questions about meat consumption. So here I'm going to use that question. So we ask about the frequency of meat eating. We have three categories of people: omnivores, flexitarian. Flexitarian are those who eat meat just a few times a month or a few times a year, and vegetarian. So vegetarian, it's about 2.2% of the population, and flexitarian about 12%. So it's consistent with several other surveys. And then we ask questions about the reality, quote unquote, of rearing conditions of animals. We ask about 10 questions. Here I put four questions associated with a figure. So we ask objective questions. So here, these are questions about frequencies. So question one here was, in your opinion, how many hens out of 100 are raised in cages? Question two, it's about the percentage of pigs who don't have access outdoor access. Question three is about the percentage of rabbits that die before the day of slaughter. And question four is about the percentage of piglets, male piglets, who are castrated without anesthesia. And so we collected the answer. So people had to guess this percentage. And what we find is that there is a slight difference between the opinions of the three categories I mentioned before: omnivore, flexitarian, and vegetarian. So here, omnivore are represented in dark blue. Flexitarian are represented in blue, and vegetarian in light blue. And you can see that the vegetarian are higher, so they have a higher perception of, let's say, animal suffering. For instance, if you take the question number four, which is about how many piglets what's the percentage of piglets castrated without anesthesia? The real number is 85%. So omnivores say 50%, the flexitarian say 65%, and the vegetarian say 82% or something. And we have repeatedly we have this ordering suggesting that there is a difference in perception depending on how much you eat meat. We ask over question. For instance, this question are it's a Likert scale. It's about ability to suffer physically on the first graph on the top and emotionally on the second graph. And again, you see a similar ranking. And the question for which we observe quite a striking difference was the one related to what has been coined in the literature the free N. So is it natural, is it normal, or is it necessary to eat meat? So these are could be perceived as justifications or excuses or narratives to justifying meat consumption. And you see that there is a quite a strong difference in the sense that omnivores are much more likely to agree with this statement that it is natural, normal, and necessary to eat meat. So overall, even though the differences are not striking, we have evidence here that there is a statistically significant difference among these categories, and that there is a correlation between meat consumption and perceived belief. And this correlation, we assume, is consistent with meat paradox in the sense that the more you eat meat, the more people tend to undermine animal suffering in the farming industry. Okay, so then let me. So we believe that this is consistent with this hypothesis, and in the rest of my talk, I will turn to the theory and I will try to explore formally what could be the implication of this hypothesis. I'm going to skip the literature on cognitive dissonance. There are essentially three strands of literature: a long-standing literature in psychology, an emerging literature in experimental economics, and a few theory papers. It seems to me that the leading theory now is Ben Abutirol, but in the paper we have an appendix where we extend the paper to Brunner, Meyer, Parker theory. Sorry, I don't have time to develop now, but I will ask questions if there are some later. So let me turn to the theory. So the model we consider is adapted from Ben Abutirol. It's a similar architecture. And in that model, there is an agent, a single agent, where this agent is going to choose both meat consumption and her beliefs. And the following Ben Abutirol, there will be an intrapersonal strategic game. So there will be a self-zero and a self-one. I see there are some questions, so don't hesitate to interrupt me if you want. So let me show you the preferences of self one. So you have a utility of meat consumption, which is C, and you represents capture the taste of meat. Then you have P, which is the price of meat. And so the first two terms represent, let's say, the standard Homo economicus utility, taste of meat and price of meat. And then the third term represents the psychological aspect. So W is the parameter of empathy or guilt, okay? And X is a critical variable here. It represents the beliefs about animal suffering. So it captures all what I've presented before, how much you perceive an animal can suffer, they can physically, emotionally, what's the size of the cage, and so on. Okay, so it's a perception of animal suffering, and we assume that there is uncertainty about that. And so for a given X, for a given perception, we denote the optimal consumption C of X, and we have an indirect utility V of X, okay, which is at the bottom of this slide. And obviously V is decreasing in X, meaning that if you could choose arbitrarily your beliefs, you will have low, you would choose X as low as possible because you want to reduce your feeling of guilt and you want to believe that animal suffering is not so high. The timing will be the following. Self-zero will observe. There will be perfect information in my presentation. In the paper is a bit more general, but it observes the real value of X and then decides to transmit a message, XH or XL. Then self one will receive that message and choose consumption. So self zero observe information, decide to transmit this information, and then self one make an action. So it's a signaling game essentially. But you understand here why it's Benabou Tirol call it a memory management model, because it's like if there is a memory problem here. You have your first self who observe information, but he can forget essentially. So he may choose to transmit or not that information to the future self. Compared to most of the model in the literature, our tiny generalization is that it's C is a continued choice, so that we can typically explore, like, for instance, the elasticity of consumption and this kind of stuff. A key dimension here is that the self zero and self one are not aligned, and what matters for self zero is the self one perception. So self zero wants self one to feel good. He wants self one not to worry too much about animal welfare, more generally about the externality, and so we will have an incentive to transmit only the good news, let's say, and to self one. So it's a Bayesian game. So so when self zero get a good news, we assume that he transmits the good news, but the interesting question is when he gets the bad news, what's going on? Will he transmit the bad news? Self one is not naive. He anticipates that self zero can lie, essentially. So when self one receives good news, he anticipates that self zero can have lied. And so he computes the reliability of the good news according to the formula that is presented here at the bottom of this slide, and sigma represents the probability to accept bad news. Okay, and so what we get here to identify the optimal strategy as the best response to sigma, it's simply it's simply computed according to the following formula. And what makes the trade-off here is the second term. So you have a benefit of self-deception. You want as a self-zero wants to manipulate the belief of self-one, but on the other end, there is a cost of lying. So if you transmit the bad news, t equal one, then the cost of self-deception is equal to zero. So you reduce the cost of self-deception, but on the other end, you don't benefit from self-deception. So you have this trade-off here that we will be at the core of a study. And so, how to interpret this cost of self-deception? It's basically the difficulty to live in a world of lies. To live in a rosy world, to look for contradictory evidence, to repress a signal, to rationalize behavior, to select the sources of information, and so on. So here it's a very simplistic model to capture this idea that we cannot have crazy beliefs. We have at some point to make an effort basically to self-deceive ourselves. So how to characterize, what's this equilibrium? We show that there exists a unique equilibrium. So let me show it with the graph. It's very simple, so that's not the central here in terms of a contribution. So given this parameter, this cost of self-deception, when K is very high, so when it's very difficult to lie to yourself, then people are always realistic. On the other end, when K is very low, people are always in denial, so they always reject bad news. And in the middle, they play mixed strategies. So that's the characterization of equilibrium. We can show that there is a negative association between meat consumption and realism, consistent with the survey study. And we can show also that the more you have, the more you like meat, the less likely you are to accept the bad news. Okay, so that's the first implication of this model, which is quite interesting. It basically, because it's going to exacerbate the heterogeneity of in the population. If people have different taste,
Nicolas,
when you have a very strong taste for meat, you have an extra incentive to lie to yourself, and at the end of the day, you will consume even more meat because of a self-deception.
Nicolas, can you hear me?
Yeah.
There is a question of understanding. Is there an interaction between the beliefs of agents? What is the source of externality?
If there are interactions between the beliefs of the agents?
Yeah.
What is the source of externality?
I'm
not sure I understand the question, but we have in the paper a situation in which we have several agents, and so that's an extension. I will not present it today for the sake of time, but in that case, in that part of the model, we allow for the possibility that you learn from observing over consumption. That's much more complex, and we just have a small extension on that, but that's much more realistic, and I think it's a very interesting direction to develop how much you in such a model, how much the interaction with others can affect your process of self-deception.
Yeah, it's okay. It was a question.
So now let me show you a little bit of comparative statistics analysis. And so an interesting question in such a model, for instance, what is the effect of price? Suppose you are in such a model in which people create an externality and they try to manipulate their belief to undermine this externality, the perception of this externality. How will change in price affect beliefs and consumption? So I will not get too much into the details, but just to give you an idea, remember how we characterize the optimal belief strategy here. And so you can see that when you differentiate that with respect to P, the P appears only in the indirect value function. And so it will be it will be always negative. And the intuition is the effect of the price is always negative. And the intuition is very easy to understand. If you have a price that increases, then you consume less meat, and so you need less self-deception. You generate less externalities, and so you feel less guilty, and you the value of self-deception is lower. And at the end of the day, if the price is very high, people are vegetarian, let's say, so they don't need to self-deceive. And so here it's interesting because in such models, prices affect beliefs. That's new in general in economics. Prices don't really change the belief you have. Very often they don't change the belief you have. And in such a model, price affects the your endogenous belief. What's the effect in terms of consumption?
Continuing, another question, sorry. The question is, does the size of the information matter? That means we could want to lie for small bad news, but not for larger ones. There is some difference.
We could lie for. So in the model, we only have bad news and a good news. So we don't really. Change the level of information, but we can do some comparative statistics on that, and we do in the paper we change XH, so we change how bad is the bad state, and then we show it's a bit tricky. It's a non-monotonic effect basically. So when the situation becomes worse, you have more of an incentive to lie to yourself, but at the end of the day, if it is very very bad, you are vegetarian, so you don't have incentive to lie. So it's a bit complex, and so we study that. It's an interesting question. So you can see that we only have a basic model here, but still it's quite rich in terms of, I think, in terms of intuitions. What's going on in terms of consumption? So here, in the y-axis, you have meat consumption as a function of price, and in the x-axis, you have the price of meat. So assume two fixed level of beliefs to make it simple. So the, suppose that you have consumption under good news, which is represented by the upper curve, and you have consumption under bad news, which is represented here by the lower curve. Okay, so that's the standard model. You will have two different levels of consumption depending on the, your information. But now go back to this model. What's going on? If price is very low, so you eat a lot of meat, you generate a lot of externality, and then in that case, you have a strong incentive to lie to yourself. So you are in denial. And so you have high level of consumption. But as soon as the price increases, then you have a lower consumption, and so you have less of the benefit of self-deception is lower. And so you adjust your belief, and you reduce your self-deception, and so you become more realistic. And because of that, because of the change in belief process, you further decrease your consumption of meat because you become more realistic. So it's let's say you have more pessimistic beliefs about the impact of the consumption of meat. And so the general implication of that is that there is a more sensitivity in such a model to a change in price because of the additional effect of price on beliefs. Okay. Another interesting comparative statistics is the change of empathy these parameters. We may anticipate a priori that if you are more altruistic to our animals, you have more empathy, you care more about others. Do you still hear me because it's written that my connection is unstable? Is it okay, Serge?
There is only 10 seconds. It was slow, but it's okay now.
Ah, okay, sorry. So what's the effect of the change in W, empathy? We may expect a priori that empathy, where you are more empathetic, you should reduce meat consumption. But in such a model, it's more subtle. Why? Because there is an effect of belief. If you have a lot of empathy, you care a lot about animals, and so you are very sensitive in a sense to animals, and so you have very strong incentive not to know the truth, and so you have a tension between the two effects. And we show in the paper that the impact of W on meat consumption depends on the elasticity of consumption. If you don't really react by a lot by changing your meat consumption, you will adjust a lot your beliefs, and this effect can eventually dominate, so that you may end up in a situation where you paradoxically when you become more empathetic, you generate more pollution, or you eat more meat in such a model. Last comparative static result I'm going to present today is about the value of information. So in such a model, we at the beginning there is perfect information that is acquired for self zero. Can observe really the state of nature. Let's compare that situation to a situation in which no information is given to self zero. And let's see whether this information is valuable by comparing these two information. Then we can show, and it's a very simplistic result, focusing only on pure strategies, that if the agent the parameters are such that the agent is in denial, then information value is negative. And on the other hand, if the parameters are such that the decision maker is realistic, then the value of information is positive. It's very easy to understand. I'm going to explain. When you are in denial, basically, every time you receive a bad news, you don't transmit that information to the agent, and so you don't benefit from the information. And so it's a pure cost for you to get information because you don't get the benefit associated with a better decision, but you got the cost of self-deception. So you prefer not to get information at all, so that you will not have to pay the cost of self-deception. So information value is negative here for those people who are in denial. On the other hand, for those people who are realistic, so they accept the bad news, then there is no cost of self-deception because they always accept the bad news. On the other hand, there is a benefit in terms of the traditional benefit of value of information. In that case, there is essentially no tension between the self-zero and self-one. And so on, under that situation, the agent will prefer to get the information. Information value is positive, as in standard decision theory. So we have an extension following the question before with social interaction. So here we have different agents. They all get the same message self-zero of each person get the common message. But at the end of the day, they can observe the over consumption. And also the externality depends on everyone's consumption. So I will not present that part today. But the main result we get here is that we have a coexistence of two equilibria, an equilibria of collective denial, so everybody denies the bad news, and focusing on pure strategies again, and an equilibrium of collective realism, which depends on the parameter value, in particular on the value of K, the cost of self-deception. So Serge, if I have a few minutes left, I can conclude with a relationship with some empirical observation, or let's say speculations about the implication of a model.
You have almost 10 minutes, so it's okay.
Okay, so that's perfect. So to conclude this paper and maybe to launch a little bit the discussion, I will try to go back to the issue of the meat paradox and to interpret some empirical observation. So I insist here on the fact that these are speculations. We don't have any empirical analysis of his observation, but we believe that this model may help understand some empirical observation related to animal welfare. So one very consistent observation is the following paradox. On the one hand, if you we look on market for food, especially some years ago, now it's changing a little bit, but I think we can be confident in the fact that the demand for animal welfare is very small. The market share of animal-friendly product is small. People don't buy much product that are supposed to be animal-friendly. So that's one fact. On the other hand, there is a lot of evidence, in particular in scientific studies, so it could be survey studies, but also experimental studies in which people purchase for real some products. There is a lot of evidence that subjects in those studies are willing to pay for animal welfare. So here there is an inconsistency. People in markets don't seem to care about animal welfare. But when they participate in studies, even in studies where they really pay for the good, they seem to care, at least some people seem to care about animal welfare. And relatedly, look at this paradox, what has been called the California egg paradox. So in 2008, in California, most of the eggs bought on the market, more than 90%, were eggs coming from battery cages, so very small cages, so low animal welfare standard. But yeah, at that time, there was a referendum called the Proposition 2, in which where people could vote against cages. They could ban cages for animals, for hens, and also for pigs. And almost two-thirds of people voted for Proposition 2, and so which generated a ban of cages in California, and also importation of eggs from hens in cage battery. So here we retrieve the inconsistency. People didn't buy eggs from battery cage, but when they could vote for it, they did so, and so they banned the cages. There might be several explanations for this paradox, but we believe that one possible explanation could be cognitive dissonance. How is that? Because of the following reason. Here we have different environment, decision-making environment. You can go to a supermarket, or you can go to a study, you participate in a survey, or you go in a lab, or you go to vote. And each environment has a different saliency about animal welfare. If you go in the supermarket, as illustrated in the picture here, most is about the quality of the meat, the prices. Animal welfare is not really there. You are in a routine process, so it's very easy to forget about animal welfare. In other words, the self-deception cost is very low. You don't really have to make an effort to forget about animal welfare. You don't think about it. It's easy to self-deceive and to buy the cheapest, to focus on the cheapest product without high animal welfare standard. On the other hand, when you participate in a study, typically in an experimental study, you will have two goods and one good will emphasize the difference in terms of animal welfare. If you participate in a survey, well, there will be questions about animal welfare. If you go to vote, as illustrated by the flyer I presented on the figure, you will see that the fact that they talk about cages, so it will be salient to you. And then it will be more difficult to engage in self-deception. Do I really want to vote against the interdiction of cages? That would be a very strong attitude. And so we believe that depending on the environment, basically the self-deception cost K changes, and that may explain the difference. In the environment in which it's easy for you to forget about animal welfare, people easily will focus on other dimension and then basically don't have to do much to reduce the level of guilt. Relatedly, that suggests in these models in which people basically choose their belief, and so they can they have a modifiable belief, that there is a role for stakeholders. In particular, this model, because the value of information could be negative, and people look for ways to self-deceive, I guess this model suggests that there is a demand for confusion. We don't really have that in the model, and I would like to think about how this model can generate a demand for confusion, let's say. But I guess it's one of the results of a model. And so you can easily think that on the one hand, the industry would try to organize this confusion to manufacture doubts, following for related, for instance, to the work by Bramboulet and Orsay. On the other hand, you can also think that NGO would try to put some information and to connect people to the reality, let's say, of the farming industry. And that's really speculation, but it's exactly what you see in the meat industry market. You will see like all the work by the industry suggesting that everything is fine, the arm is well raised, which doesn't mean anything. The cow, the lavage qui rit, or the pâté de cochon with the illusion of happy animal, or the consenting victim. And also, look at these ads by Bulbanker. They suggest that everything is fine. It's good for the air, good for animals. Okay, we kill animals, it's good for them, and it's good for the environment, which are just, this is just making confusion. And on the other hand, what do you see with NGOs? You see that they make an effort to organize a shock campaign. So we interpret that as a way to break the meat paradox. Typically, you will see when you see animal activists, they will on the stage, you will have people taking the place of the animals. So that people can reconnect to the fact that meat is a person it generates basically the killing and maybe the suffering. You see some activists on the top right picture, they go in the supermarket and they put some flyers with the head of the animal so that people who buy this meat remember that this was a person, this was a cow that was killed for them. Okay, and typically, you know, in France, we have this very active NGO, L214, and their motto is ouvrons les yeux sur l'élevage et les abattoirs. So it's really about let's see what's going on in the farming industry. We interpret that as consistent with a meat paradox. Final word. So what I want to suggest here is that I think there could be follow-up work, and I would be interested to work on that. And I'm happy to collaborate on that, where we should think of a model with people who manipulate their belief and stakeholders that try to mode to affect these beliefs. And what would be the outcome of such a game? And a final question is, what would be the role for the government? Of course, there are questions about what is welfare here, but at first sight, we might believe that government may want to please the industry, and in the same time, they want to please most consumers, and most consumers, they want to eat meat without feeling guilty. So I guess the government here has an incentive not to be too transparent. He has an incentive to hide what's going on in the farming industry, and more generally, when there is an industry creating externalities that people don't want to see. And this is typically what we see in the farming industry. There are laws. There are laws in the US. There are laws now in France, where you can penalize activists who go in the farming industry and take pictures or videos and put it on the web. In the US, you can go to prison, and you have very high penalty. And these laws have been very criticized. Now in France, we have similar laws going on with a specific government agency, Demeter, who is trying to chase animal activists. And we may interpret that as an incentive to reduce transparency and basically to facilitate the process of self-deception of consumers. That's it.
Thank you very much, Nicolas, for your presentation. Very clear presentation and very clear English. Thank you for that. And okay, we don't have a lot of questions. Before I wanted to ask, you are talking about animal suffering, but not killing. So, is it included? Imagine you are in a world where suffering, nice world where there is no suffering, but only the fact that people doesn't like to the fact that animals are killed. Is your model is including that can affect the result, or I didn't well understand.
So in the model here, it's a black box. We have a parameter X which represents animal suffering, and it can capture everything. It can capture the suffering during the raising of animals, during the transport of animals, during the killing of animals. So it's really not really addressed in the paper. But in practice, it's really an important question. There are different stages, and animals may suffer in all the stages. When they are raised, when they are transported, and when they are killed. There are, for instance, this discussion about killing without stunning of animals. So that's a very important discussion. And there is a related discussion also about the age at which animals are killed. Even though the animals may live a fine life, so for instance, you can think of cows are raised outside, still, essentially, all animals in the farming industry have a very low life expectancy. For the typical chickens, live just about six to eight weeks. So it's very small longevity, I would say.
Okay, thank you. So I have some question on both boxes. So first, do you include income levels and income effect? How different income could be affect your results?
Yes, it's a good question. As you may have seen, the model was very simple. And if you look at that, can you see it on the screen, Serge?
Sorry?
You can see the...
Yeah.
So there is no income here, so we don't have income effect. So we don't really study that, even though we may maybe interpret it as a, I mean, it's related to a change in price. Price may affect people with different income differently. But anyway, it's not a short answer. It's not in the models. We didn't study how income affect the trade-offs here.
Okay, now I have a lot of questions, so I have to select some question regarding option in terms of public policy. Did you ask yourself or did you conduct static comparatives to see whether policies on prices, tax on meat consumption, for example, were more effective than a policy based on information and communication?
So we didn't do that. We don't compare different policies. So we did, we didn't really study the role of the government. Here we just change parameters. So we change P or we change information. So it's useful to interpret what could be the impact of some policies, but we don't discuss different instruments. We don't compare instruments. And as I suggested during the presentation, if we want to think about the role of government, we need to define what is the objective of a government. And talking about price or information, for instance, we need to be precise about what the government would want to do. The government, if the government cares about consumers, for instance, then we have to decide about whether the government is going to care about the objective beliefs or the beliefs that have been manipulated by the consumer. So I have a paper with François Salanier, and there are other papers in the literature. We discuss this a little bit, and so that this exercise, I guess, could be developed here. It depends on the choice of welfare, the optimal policy we design in terms of information and in terms of prices.
Okay, thank you. Another question, do you have any empirical evidence to corroborate your proposition on the effect of price? It seems to stem from the cost of self-deception, which is increasing with consumption in the model. And one could imagine that it is Boolean or decreasing. It means, okay, an example.
So
person, I feel guilty. But once I get used to it, I don't feel guilty anymore.
Say it again. Excuse me, Serge, can you say it again?
Yes. And Sophie would like to know if you have any empirical evidence to corroborate your proposition on the effect of price. You want to continue?
So on that part, no, we don't. And indeed, there is a testable prediction. I mean, testable. At least we propose a prediction. We suggest that there is more sensitivity regarding price when people have such cognitive dissonance. I'm not sure how we can design really a test of that. I think it would be very interesting to do so. I know that Jason Lusk, who is a famous researcher in agricultural economics, when I presented the paper, he tried to see whether there is a correlation between the change in price and the perception regarding animal welfare, and he didn't find any effect. I'm not sure if it was a good test of this, but anyway, at this point, the short answer is no, I don't have any empirical evidence.
Yeah. And we have several questions about habits. How could habits affect your outcomes?
So habits are very important, and I guess in food consumption and meat consumption, these are central. We are really attached to meat. So there is a lot of evidence on that. Meat is good. It has been evolutionary selected, and so we want to keep eating meat. We like meat, and so it's very important, and I guess it's central here. We are so attached to meat. It's so difficult for us to give up meat that that's the core of the story, in fact. The cost of changing action is very strong, and so we try to find ways to go around that cost, and one way is to just change beliefs, and collectively maybe we coordinate so that we don't think too much about it. So it's, we don't have a bit. The short answer is that we don't have a bit in the model, but yeah, I'm not sure it would change too much. What I think would be interesting though is habits formation is typically a dynamic aspect, so we can we could have this sort of dynamic aspects. I never thought about how this could change to have more dynamics into the model and the history dependence, let's say. It's a good question.
Thank you. Another question. The negative price of information may lead a part of the population to approve the anti-whistleblower laws. It's a question.
The people, so the population approve anti-whistle. So at the end of the talk, I suggested that there are anti-whistleblower laws. That's true. But then the question is that people may approve these anti-whistleblower laws. Huh?
The question is the negative price of information may lead part of the population to approve the anti-whistleblower laws.
Yes, many people are better off if there is no information. So that's consistent with the fact that they are happy with a policy that is going to generate anti-whistleblower law, and so that we limit the information. So that was indeed what I suggested in at the end. Even though I don't have, showed that formally, and I think it would be interesting to be more precise and rigorous about this this implication.
Okay, thank you. I don't see any more question. Ah, yes, from Stefan. Have you thought about a similar framework on the supply side? That is on the part of farmers. There may be similar mechanisms at play for them, empathy with animals or guilt. I am wondering about the comparative statistic regarding the price effect on supply.
So I understand the question as a question about farmers. So here we have consumers, and then we may wonder about farmers and whether they are cognitive dissonant. So my sense here is that farmers have stronger incentives. They have, in the sense that they, not only they probably eat meat, but also their profit depends on meat consumption. So they have very strong incentives to self-deceive and to feel that, to say to themselves, everything is fine with the farming industry. My practices are fine, the animal don't suffer, and so on. On the other end, they know a lot. So it's very difficult for them to really ignore information. They know a lot because they do the job. They are on the ground. And so my conjecture is based on what I've seen, in particular on social networks, is that farmers are really into the justification. They know the facts, but that's my interpretation, but they make up narratives. We always did like this. The men are omnivores and it's fine to eat meat. It's fine to separate the baby from the cow and so on. So we need to do that. It's part of our culture and so on. So they make up narratives. And I think this contribute to help them to feel better about their job, which necessarily involves some part of suffering, I guess.
Okay, thank you. I just check. Yeah, maybe last question from Christophe Guel. What could be the expected effects of animal welfare laws? On the one hand, they could reduce animal suffering and so increase meat consumption at constant prices. On the other hand, they could raise information about animal suffering. Opposite effects.
Very good question. So in the paper, we change XH. So how bad is the world in terms of the suffering of animals? So we do comparative statistics of that. And I explained already that it's complex, but we don't have a price effect. We didn't examine whether a change in XH is also going to change the price typically. So without that, it's already complex and ambiguous. So it would be even more complex, I guess, if we add an additional effect in terms of the impact of the price. But it's a very good question, and I guess maybe there is more work to be developed here to explore what will happen if we change the quality, let's say, of the rearing condition with several effects on the price and on beliefs and at the end of the day on consumption.
Thank you. I don't see more questions. I just check on my two screens. So it's okay, we are on time. So I can thank you, Nicola, once again. Just for information, we were more than 50 participants to watch you. And another information is that you permitted to the recording of your presentation. This presentation will be online in 1 week. So we can enjoy again your presentation or for people who miss the seminar. Lionel, if you want to close.
Yes, thanks a lot. I have just a word for the organizing members. Please stay online with us. We have to